So what I want to do here is, I was not intending to give a presentation on a specific individual species, but rather an overview of the species that are found in India, the groups that are found in India, and some of the common characters that you can use to identify them in the field. So one of the things you'll notice is that if you ever contact a herpetologist with a photograph, I think it's true with most taxonomies, as a photograph for a, you know, information for some species, first thing they ask for is scale counts. Without scale counts, it's very difficult to specifically identify each individual. But we want to come up with some sort of a way in which we can identify animals in the field without actually having to catch it or, you know, make a specimen out of it. So I try to concentrate on those characters. Those are not exactly taxonomy characters, but that will be helpful in identifying at least groups of lizards. So I wanted to give a general picture of the lizard diversity that we have. We have 9 families in India, about 237 species, a number that keeps going up. But if you look at the distribution of species richness within that, you see that most of the species fall into these 3 categories, the Gekkonidae, Adiomedae, and Skincidae. So that itself is an indication that if you find a lizard in the field somewhere, chances are it falls into one of these 3, even though we have 9 families. So I'll go through each of these groups and try to point out some of the characters that will be useful. For example, Gekkonidae. Geckos are probably the most familiar lizard to all of us. They're found everywhere in the houses, and mostly when you say a lizard, most people think of a house gecko. But it's a very species rich group. Some of the general characteristics are almost all the species have a dorsally flattened body, because they are most species are arboreal. Even the terrestrial ones, they'll be climbing rocks, and because of their climbing abilities, they have very differently shaped toes. Many species have expanded lamellae under the toe. So these are some of the characters that if you have a specimen in hand, you can see. But otherwise, you have to look at other characters. Like most geckos have the head and body are covered in small granular scales. Not like for example a snake, which will have, you know, more regular. If you've seen the head scales of a snake, it's plate-like. But geckos have small granular scales. And the characters of these scales, like if they are smooth or they have tubercles, or how these tubercles are spaced, these are all the characters used in identification of individual species. Also, geckos have immovable eyelids. You know, the eyelid, they cannot close the eye. This is one of the reasons you see geckos licking their eyes to clean it. So, characteristics of this family. Almost all geckos have an ear opening. You can see the ear opening. There's a little hole behind the eye. And most species are nocturnal. Now, there are some groups that have become diurnal. These characters independently evolved in multiple groups. For example, the Nemaspis, which is the day gecko. You find them here also. They are mostly diurnal or crepuscular geckos. And they also have a round pupil. So most of the other nocturnal species, they'll have vertical pupils. Some species have even horizontal pupils. We don't have an example of that in India. So most of the species have vertical pupils. But the species that are more diurnal, they'll have a round pupil. And of course, Phelsuma. Phelsuma andamanensis is a very interesting gecko that's found only in the Andaman Islands. All its relatives are in the Madagascar and Seychelles Islands and those areas. But one species in the Andamans. This also has it's a diurnal species, and it also has a round pupil. Also, geckos are unique among lizards in that most lizards do not vocalize. They have some species have a hissing mechanism, but geckos are the only group that have actually the ability to vocalize and produce calls. So, this is some of the probably the most common species that we have. Hemidactylus brookii that is distributed throughout most of India. Of course, there is a species complex within that. Also, this I have taken a lot of photos from the biodiversity portal for this. Like this beautiful species, the colligal brown gecko that was photographed near Bangalore, I think. So the next group is Euglepharidae, or these are called leopard geckos. These are a larger you know, body size wise is the largest species, most of them. And they are very much in demand in the pet trade because they are very colorful, you know. These are nocturnal species mostly and terrestrial. But the characteristic is that they have movable eyelids. This is the only group of gecko that can actually close its eye. So sometimes they are also grouped within the other family, but for now it's considered a separate family. So they have vertical pupils and very bright colors. Also you notice a very thick tail. And they don't have particular expansions of lamellae under the toe. We have about four species. I think this is Eublepharus fuscus. Abhishek Narayan photographed this. The next, this is one of the largest groups of lizards in the world. And also, I think most of the species are skinks. So skinks are characterized by the head covered in large plate-like scales, very snake-like. In, you know, the head of the skink looks very snake-like. So they have overlapping body scales, which are much larger, not like gecko's granular scales. You know, very similar to snakes. And this character is very important. They have relatively short limbs. So you will see a nice progression within the skinks from having fully formed muscular legs to forms that are, you know, progressively more elongated and reducing the length of the limbs to forms that are completely limbless, you know, burrowing species. They all have a very muscular but very fragile tail. They have a tail autotomy. Ear opening is present in all the species, and eyelids are movable in most of the species, except a recently discovered species a couple of years back from Meghalaya, which have gecko-like eyes. Basically, the eyelid is immovable. Spinomorphous apalpebratus. So the big photo is the one probably the, I think the commonest species that we have. It's called the Brahmini skink or the keel grass skink. But then you have forms like the little skink, which is Macularia. And the Spinomorphous disseminari, which is mostly distributed in southern Kerala, those regions, and much more elongated Lygosoma albopunctata. That species is from northeast India. So next is the Lacertail. So this I see in the biodiversity portal that when people upload photographs, there is a lot of confusion between skinks and Lacertails. How to separate between them? Lacertidae are also a species which family, but in India we only have 14 species. So they also have large regular head scales, and some of the lacertids have gecko-like eyes. This is, they are also called snake eyes because of the inability to close the eyes. So Tachydromus and Acanthodactylus, they have eyelids that are movable, but Ophisops, the genus Ophisops, has immovable eyelids. And also compared to skinks, they have a more rough scale appearance. They don't have the shine of the body scales. And if you look at the limb lengths also compared to skinks, they have longer legs and longer toes, and they're much more faster. I mean, skink sensors are faster. If you ever try to catch a skink, you'll see how. And lacertids are much faster than skinks. And also many species have very, very long tails. For example, this is a very interesting lizards on the right, Tachydromus exlineatus, photographed by Vijayan from Assam. This species' tail is like as much as 5 times its the length of the body. So if the lizard is 5 centimeters, the tail can be 25 centimeters long. Very long tail. And then we have fringe-toed lizards, which are found in deserts of India. Next. This is another familiar group. Most of the people are familiar with the garden lizards and agamas. Calotes versicolor, one of our best documented species in the biodiversity world. So most of the agamids are diurnal species. They can be terrestrial or arboreal, and agamids show pronounced sexual dimorphism. And the males in the breeding season are usually easiest to identify. They don't have those large plate-like structures on the head. Again, they have small scales, but usually the body scales are keeled. They have tympanum, which is, this is not an opening like in geckos and other species. There is a ear opening, but there is an exposed tympanum. It can be hidden in some species, and you have also look at the size, shape and variation or the orientation of the scales of the body for individual species identification. But almost all agamids are remarkable that they have this ornamentation. this is probably a result of sexual selection or something like that, that they have spines on the back or on the head, and some species like the draco, for example, they'll have wing-like expansions called patagia, which help them glide from trees to trees. So most ornamental lizards are highly ornamented and very colorful. And this other species is Somophilus dorsalis. Now there are two species of Somophilus in India, and I think this is probably the second most photographed lizard in IPP, but it's also one of the most unidentified, because the two species are very difficult to identify based on photographs alone, unless some key characters are visible in the photograph, like the nature of the scale, for example, whether the scales are smooth or keeled. You need high resolution photos. Of course, the actual identification of all the species will require counting of the scales around the body and on the head, things like that. Chameleonidae is represented by just one species in India. It's a very species within Madagascar and Africa, but we have one species. It's mostly diurnal, arboreal. Very difficult to misidentify this species. You look at the curled tail, it's a strongly prehensile tail, and their eyes are also covered in a thick granular lid, and they have the strong sticky tongue, and also the zygodactyl has limbs, which means the fingers are fused, fingers and toes are fused together for better gripping on the branches. Their tympanum is completely hidden. So just one species, but we have very few observations of this species in the portal. I guess that's probably because how difficult it is to spot one of these in the vegetation. Probably that's the reason, because it's not an indication of how common it actually is. Angulae, we have only just one species. It's called these are called glass lizards. This species is found only in the northeast India. Dopacia gracilis is the thing. So they don't have limbs, and they are also very skink-like in appearance, but the body scales are more squarish, smooth body scales. And one of the differences between snakes and this, if you see a snake or a limbless lizard, you have to look for the ear opening. Snakes do not have ear openings, and these glass lizards have ear opening, and they can also close their eyes, unlike snakes. So these characters will help you separate between a glass lizard or a limbless skink and snakes. And they also have smooth, shiny body scale, and very colorful species also. And another limbless group of lizards is the Dibamidae. And you're not likely to come across one of this, because it's only found in the Nicobar Islands, and you have to be digging through leaf litter or in the forest somewhere to find one of this. But very interesting species. Its head bones are all fused together to form a nice shovel for digging into the ground and all. The eyes are also covered by scales, which is typical in many burrowing taxa, but only found in the Nicobar Islands. There are many species in Southeast Asia. And the other group of common lizards that we have are varanids. So we have four species. The Bengal monitor, the one on the top right. The middle one is a yellow monitor. The bottom one is a water monitor. And we don't have a photo of the desert monitor. But the easiest way to identify them from photographs is if you look at the position of the nostrils. For a Bengal monitor, the nostril is situated about halfway between the tip of the snout and the eye, right? If you look at yellow monitor, that is Varanus flavescens, it's closer to the tip of the snout. And the water monitor has a very narrow, long snout with a small tubular opening. Nostril is a very small tubular opening and much more towards the tip of the snout. And if you look at the desert monitor, that nostril is very close to the eye. So these characters are, you can easily see this in photographs, and you can easily identify them based on these characters. One additional feature for the desert monitor is that the tail in cross section is round. Most other species of monitor lizards have a keel, or it's a flattened, laterally flattened sort of a tail. So there is a nice keel which actually helps them swim through water and all. But the desert monitors have a round tail. So this should help you identify them in the field or from photographs. So I think the best thing to identify lizards in the field is to get hold of field guides. Unfortunately, we don't have any dedicated field guides for lizards in India. There are some general field guides and some regional field guides that you can use, which include snakes and frogs and other things. As far as I know, just one, the Indrajit Das book that is there for throughout India, it covers some of the common species. And then there are some regional field guides. I put some of them here to try and get hold of them and use them for identification of these animals in the field. And yeah, thanks.